So I have to start off by saying thank you to Kathleen. And you're right, I should have been on AirAsia. It took me 48 hours to get here from New York City. And I'm not going to mention the airline because they're not worth mentioning anymore. But I did see on your Facebook update this morning that you mentioned that fact. And I've both tweeted and updated my Facebook to represent that. So thank you. I also want to say thank you to the iStrategy folks for allowing us to be here. We now have a presence in Singapore. We brought Stephen Dolan in, who's sitting over here from Microsoft around 5 months ago, 6 months ago, to launch our offices here in Singapore, covering off on Southeast Asia, and we're actually building a pretty robust team. So thank you for allowing us to come in this morning and spend some time. I'm going to talk about 40 minutes, and then leave some time at the end for questions. When I got off the plane this morning, one of the things, I do use lots of different social media, and so I quickly kind of got on and looked at my Facebook and looked at Twitter, and all of a sudden found out that Groupon has been acquired. Everybody see that? $5.3 billion. Our friends at Google. Well done. It's an amazing recognition of where the world's going. Time will tell whether those valuations are right or wrong. I don't have an opinion one way or another. But it is a world that's moving very, very fast. There are lots of different players in it, and I'll talk a little bit about all of them. But it just amazed me that happened so quickly. I also would recommend, I picked up in New York when I left, the Harvard Business Review. I don't know how many people in the room read the Harvard Business Review. I don't read it all the time. I'm not one of those kinds of people. But it did say social media and branding. And it's got some really unique articles about the challenges that CMOs and CEOs and companies are facing and the radical change that's taking place. And for a publication like the Harvard Business Review to cover off on that, I thought it was just interesting. So worth a read if you get a chance. You can find it online or go buy it for a lot of money. So what I do ask people to do, and how many people are kind of digital folks in the room versus traditional? How many digital? And how many more traditional folks are in the room? Okay, so this is for you six people. Right? One of the things I often do is we're still in a world where people think a certain way, right? And I still think we think a certain way about digital to some degree. So what I do ask people to do in some of these conversations or these presentations is to think for an hour, take off our hats, and to think a little differently about the world. I'm pretty passionate about this statement that the ability to define a brand and control a brand has been taken out of the hands of brand managers and has shifted to their communities. I mean, I've gone so far, and some people really don't like it when I say this, but I say it anyway because that's kind of who I am. If a brand manager doesn't understand the fact that they've lost control of their brand, they should be fired. It's a fact, right? Brand managers now are moving towards much more of community managers. They're suggesting brand promises. They're understanding their product. They're there for distribution. They're running P&Ls. But the idea of controlling a brand has shifted so fundamentally that if people don't recognize that, they're already so far behind the curve, it'll be very difficult for them to catch up. It did not happen overnight. So I kind of go through this, this spectrum or this timeline of discovery. And I'm just going to build it very quickly because it allows me to speak to it a little bit easier. So when I grew up, and I'm old enough to remember the world before the internet, when I grew up, I kind of lived over here. If I wanted to find out information about something, I went to a big book. Right? If I wanted to find out where to buy something, I went to the Yellow Pages. If I wanted to go find something, what was playing at the cinema, I had to buy a newspaper. Right? That was the world we grew up in. That wasn't that long ago. I still remember it really well. And then the original days of, I remember when Jerry Yang and David Filo created Yahoo. The original page was really simple. If you went to yahoo.com, you saw a little note that said, hey, here's some cool websites you might like. That's all it was. It was a directory. It's evolved into a portal as we know it today. But that was a directory business as it was originally based. And then search came in, and search became the dominant player in how you discovered information, and still plays a very dominant role in how people find things in today's world. Then the world, then we moved a little bit further right, went to user-generated content. I remember that was UGC, it was such a big deal for about 2 years. Everybody was wondering where the world was going and how do we control it. And we think fundamentally where it's moved even further now to the right is we find information through our friends. Right? We find information through social networks. We find information through our social graph. There's a whole new set of ways for people to find that information. And this is just something that, you know, is a fundamental fact. Right? Facebook's now driving more traffic to portals than Google is. More people are finding their news via their news feed on Facebook than via Google. That doesn't mean that Google and search is changing or going away. It just means that the playing field is changing fairly significantly. How people are finding things on a day-to-day basis is through their friends. It's not just Facebook. Facebook happens to be a big player, and it happens to be almost synonymous with social media. There are lots of really great players. You know, Twitter's been mentioned a few times. It plays an important role in lots of people's lives. Right? There are local players around the world. You know, if you go to Japan, you have Mixi. If you go to China, you have QQ. The role they play in people's lives might change. But fundamentally, people are engaging with and connecting with in a very different kind of way than they ever used to. There's a generation coming up now that lives their entire lives on social networks. If you look at 13, 14-year-olds, email is not something they'd ever dare get involved with. Email is how they connect with their grandparents. It's a fact, right? We laugh about that, but it is true. And increasingly, their grandparents are now in places like Facebook because that's how they connect with their grandkids or their children. That's how they keep up to date with people they care about. The world is changing. If you look at all the statistics around the world, you'll see that. Those facts jump out at you. I'm not going to go through all the statistics because it would be boring. But those numbers are resounding, they're real. And it's not going back. Right. What people have to do now, what brands have to do now, is understand what role they play in that world and adjust themselves to the point where they can actually be relevant. Because traditional ways of thinking about things don't work anymore. It is around connections. It's as simple as that. Social graph is not new. The social graph has been around since the beginning of time, right? Our relationships, my direct and indirect relationships with my family and friends, has been something that way before the internet existed. You know, if you're an anthropologist, you go back to the beginning of time. It's how people connect. It's the reason the newspapers existed, to connect people in different places, to share information. All we've done now is laid technology on top of it that allows us to share that information in a much more relevant and a faster way. So technology has caught up to human need. At the end of the day, though, and this is something I implore people to think about, right? It's about people. So we can talk about technology, we can talk about retargeting, we can talk about, you know, demand-side platforms, we can talk about lots of different things which we in our world have a sense of doing, because that's what we do. We know the technology better than anybody else. But at the end of the day, this is who we're interacting with. When you put yourself into the social media world, you're putting yourself into relationships. That requires a different level of commitment, and Kathleen referenced that earlier. It requires a commitment. So that's Mark. He's now 26, right? And he's probably one of the most phenomenal people I've ever met in my life. And I don't say that lightly. I've been fortunate enough to have met a lot of the folks that have created these great big internet companies. And Mark Zuckerberg sits up alongside of all of them. Mark interviewed me for my job when I was the first international employee of the company 3 years ago in London. And so Mark said, before we hired this guy, I want to meet with him. And so I flew to New York. He flew in from Palo Alto at the time. I was a big Yahoo exec. He was an entrepreneur. And about half an hour after we were supposed to meet, I'm kind of sitting there dressed like this, like a 40-year-old businessman. And Mark walks in, and he looks like a kid, right? He just does, right? Mark is very young-looking. He's very youthful. And he's very humble, and he's shy, and he is, and I didn't know what to make of him, to be honest with you. And so I kind of thought to myself, well, I'm going to ask why Facebook. This is back when MySpace was still a dominant player at Facebook. It was before Facebook went through its enormous growth stage. So I was going to challenge him on all these reasons. Why is Facebook going to be around in 10 years? And why should I come join this company? And then he started asking questions. And I realized that I was sitting with someone who actually had a really strong concept of the role that brands play within this world and the role that Facebook plays in the world. And I quickly realized I was sitting in front of someone who just thinks differently than I did. Right? I come from a world, right, where working with big internet companies where everything we did was, how do we make money doing it? Right? Any decision we made at Yahoo was, how do we monetize that? Before any business got approved, it had to be a $50 million business. If it wasn't a $50 million business, it got thrown away. That's just the way the world worked. Mark couldn't care less about any of that. His objective was to connect the world. It's still his objective. He wants to create social change at a scale unheard of, unprecedented before. He's using Facebook to do that. He's a visionary, and I wish everybody could have a chance to meet with him or just kind of feel for that, because he does think differently. He views the world through a different filter than you and I do. And I'm going to try and give you a flavor for that over the next half an hour or so, and how we make decisions and the culture we built, the way we view our users, the way we view developers, and the way we view advertisement brands. Because it's very, very different. We think the world is just different, and the way you build a global business has fundamentally changed. So this is a video, and you're going to hear from both Chris Cox, who runs product for us, and you're going to hear from Mark. And they're going to really talk to you about what role and what Facebook's doing and the way they view the world.
I always imagine, what are we doing? What is Facebook actually doing? What's the point?
At any given point in time, there are the trends that are really shaping society. We just think that the world is better off when everyone has a voice.
Facebook is giving the power of distribution to every single person. No longer can people go make a law that can constrain the flow of ideas.
And our idea has always been that the real way to organize the world's information is people. And that's this completely bottom-up way of establishing for the whole world, like, what is the map of human connections?
We've always talked about this as a movement, not as a website. The reason why we built a company is because I think a company is by far the best way to get the best people together and align their incentives around doing something great. We're kind of in the sweet spot now, and it will be for the next few years, where the company is large enough that there's room for people to come in and experiment with things and have a lot of leverage in what they do. And it's also not so large that you're going to get lost in that, right? We build a lot of tools that make it so that engineers can have low friction for getting started in an idea, can get machines if they want to test something out, have a good environment to build things. We push code every single night. So it's really a magical time for the company, and a lot of great people are joining now because of that. We are way closer to the beginning of this than the end, and this is the type of thing that can get a billion people using it. And decisions that we make now, and people who are joining now, are really getting into the ground floor in terms of shaping the direction this is going to go in.
So we've crossed 500 million users. I was going to put an asterisk on this, because we've actually, over the weekend, we passed 600 million users. Right? We're not going to make an announcement, because Mark doesn't want to make an announcement until we're further along. This is how he thinks about the world, right? When I was at a different company, every little tiny reason we had to make a big deal, we'd make a big deal about it. We just don't think of it that way. Yes, 600 million users is a good number for us. It shows we've grown from 500 million to 600 million people since July. So we've added 100 million users in 4 months. But we're not there yet, right? Mark wants to connect the world. 600 million is just a step to get there. We've got well over 200 million mobile users around the world. Mobile is by far the fastest growing part of our business. And we don't talk about these numbers, primarily because there's no advertising on any of it, right? The world's, the number I saw in the UK when I was running the European business for the company earlier this year was that 50% of all mobile internet time was spent on Facebook in the UK. 50% of all mobile time. And people come to me and they go, Blake, how come you're not monetizing this? What's the advertising model? There is none, right? That would create friction. We don't believe the advertising world on mobile is where it should be or where it's going to be. And so why put advertising on there if all it's going to do is slow down user adoption? It's just the way the company thinks. An interesting stat that's not on this page is that 50% of our users, so 50% of our 600 million users, come back every single day. Right? When I was at another company, if 10% of our users came back in a day, they were popping champagne bottles. It was an exciting time. 50% of the users come back every day. Sheryl Sandberg, who's our chief operating officer, joined us from Google shortly after I joined, heard that number. I remember we were using it as a sales organization to talk about, you know, how interactive and how engaged our audience was. And she said, will you please take that number out of any presentation you're using? And we were all like, but that's a value, like it's really important. She's like, well, we're at 60 million users. That's what we were at the time, we're at 60 million users. And she's like, and these are obviously the early adopters. And as Facebook becomes more mass, right, that number will go down because early adopters consume technology different than mass audiences do. The number's actually closer to 60% than 50%. And every time she looks at it, she goes, I can't believe it. I was the adult. I told the company not to use that number. And yet we're at 600 million users and more than 50% come back every day. We're a relatively international company. When I joined the company, around 50 million users at that time, 80% of our users were in the US. We were English only. Right? So in 3 years, we're now 80% international, and we're in over 90 languages. And we did it in a very different way. Right? We used translation services. We used our community to translate our site around the world for us. Most companies, when they actually want to go into France, right, we'll go and they'll put a whole bunch of people into Paris, they'll translate, and they'll say, let's build a business there. We just didn't think that was scalable. That's not in Mark's mind, that's not using technology and users and community to efficiently build a business around the world. We have three distinct audiences, and you'll hear me use the words efficiency, effectiveness, and scale a lot. It's everything we do. We're a global company. We build product globally. We don't build stuff in the French market or the Singapore market or the Japanese market any differently. We build it in the US or the UK or Brazil. Everything's global in nature to us. We look at our users, we have developers, and we have our advertisers. The reality of it is that's the sequence in which we think about our business. Right? So sometimes that creates frustrations. I remember when I first joined, I used to get frustrated that we wouldn't go and build something for someone who said, we have a lot of money to spend with you. Blake, I've got X amount of money and I want to spend it with Facebook and I need you to do this. So I'd go back to the product team and I'd say, you know, there's a big opportunity revenue-wise. And the product guys would go, no, thank you. Hello? So when we think about the world, we think about it from a user. The developers, with over 100 million developers around the world, is an important part of our constituency. Right? They're the people who are building content. Right? Remember when we built the developer platform 3 years ago, it was not an open internet at that time. Today we talk about openness, open APIs. Everybody's open. Everybody's building on top of Google. They're building on top of Yahoo. They're building on top of Microsoft. They're building on top of Apple. Right? At the time, nobody was building on top of anybody. I remember I was at Yahoo in the time when they announced the developer platform, and we scratched our heads and said, why in the world would they open up the world to other people? They've opened up their audience to third parties, and they're not going to monetize it at all? The world the way it was back then was you built something, you surrounded it, right? You kept all the information, you monetized it yourself, and Mark just said that's not the way we can do it. We can't build product around the world. That requires putting people in every market in the world to be relevant. So they opened up the developer platform. Again, at the time, it was unheard of. It would never have been done. And today, it's pretty much universal. So our users, we look at it in three key ways. It's pretty pure and simple. Right? Our users are everything to us. We have to allow them to have an identity. Right? They have to feel like they can connect with and find people they care or brands they care about. And they have to be able to share information. So everything we do, when we build, we don't go through radical transformations. Yes, we might change a visual or things like that. But the basic premise of allowing people to connect and share is the reality. 3 years ago, I would never have put my mobile telephone number on the internet. I just wouldn't have done it. Right? If I'd done it, I would have thought that like my entire identity would be stolen, my bank accounts would be emptied, someone would steal my house, my child would get kidnapped, right? You wouldn't put personally identifiable information on the internet. You just wouldn't do it. Right. And that's the way it is now. I mean, because of Facebook, people are actually, their real identities are there. Because they have a confidence that information is not going to be shared. People aren't going to be able to get to it. That's the trust factor that we have with our users. We have a pretty, we've gone through a pretty radical transformation with our photos product, right? And I'm going to give you an example of sharing and connecting. And I'll throw these in, these little antidotes in once in a while. Our photos product is actually pretty bad on a relative basis. If you go in, it's not high def, right? It's pretty low def, actually. It doesn't have red eye remover. You can't crop. You can't change, right? We launched it, and we've got now around 80 billion photos on Facebook. The next largest player, I read about 2 or 3 weeks ago, is Flickr. And Flickr just announced its 5 billionth photo. We're doing 5 billion a month at this point. Now, with such a poor quality product, what do you think, does anybody in the room have any idea why it's popular? Who said that? Tagging. Tagging. Simple concept to be able to tag your friends transformed photo sharing. Transformed it. Those are the little ways we look at our user experience. How do we make little adjustments, not big, crazy things, but how do we just allow people to share a little bit more with their friends and family? It's real people, real identities, right? I am Blake Chanley. I've got a wonderful son, right? I am 44 years old. I can't dance, right? I support Liverpool, which is the worst football club on the earth, right? Just, I am who I am. If I try to be someone else, my friends wouldn't allow it. They would call me out. They'd put videos up. They'd make fun of me. It just wouldn't work. Right? So it's real people. The news feed was something that didn't exist at Facebook. When Facebook was first launched at Harvard and with all the university, there was no news feed. It basically, the way I found information was I typed in my friends' names and I'd go find them and I'd read what they were doing. When Facebook launched news feed, there were around maybe, at the time, 4 million users at the time. They launched News Feed. There were literally riots in the streets. Companies located right outside Stanford University, the police had to get involved. Because everybody was saying, that we don't want that. Right? You violated our privacy. You're now sharing information. This News Feed thing was, I think, 30% of the entire Facebook population joined a group saying, get rid of News Feed. Now, as a traditional brand manager, if 30% of your users raise their hand and said, we hate the product you've changed, we hate what you've done to your product, most brand managers would go, okay, whoa. They'd back off and they'd go back to where they were. Mark just said, that's just the way it's going to be. It's the evolution of where it's going to go. And now the world without news feeds, kind of like the world without sunshine. I don't know. How would you find information about people? It is your personal newspaper. The developer platform. Talked a little bit about before. You know, we reinforce, we want developers on top of Facebook platform. We don't charge developers anything. It's free. They have to comply with terms and conditions. They have to write in FBML, which is Facebook meta language, which took me a long time to figure out what FBML meant, right? Over 1 million developers around the world are building on top of that now. They're building some really interesting things. Does anybody recognize this? How many people in the room are on or have been on Farmville? Oh, come on. You guys, you know, half the room's been on Farmville at some point, right? The concept of gardening, of planting crops, and sharing those crops with your friends is something in my wildest imagination I would never imagine anybody wanting to do. And yet there are hundreds of millions of people doing it. They're doing it because they connect with their friends in an interesting way. I walked down, right after Farmville had been launched, I remember I walked down onto our sales floor in London. It was about 8:30, 9 o'clock in the morning, and every single computer screen had Farmville open. I kind of looked around. No one even looked up when I walked in. They were all planting their crops and buying purple cows, right? I was like, what is going on here? It's fascinating. The developer community builds these things. I can't tell you how many times I've come up and people have said to me, hey, Blake, that's really cool. I go, we didn't build it. It's adding to the value of the social graph. For advertisers, it's about creating and promoting. Right? This is not a broadcast medium. Anybody know what that is? Someone's got to know what that is. Okay, so that is the, go ahead. Very good. The first ever banner ad for AT&T. The reason no one knows what it is, because our media still looks like that. Right? For the most innovative media that had ever been introduced, we didn't innovate very much. Right? Yeah, they might have some rich media stuff going on. They might be smarter, the advertising. Right? So it might be able to target better, retarget, give you information. But at the end of the day, we basically took traditional and old media and kind of stuck it on the internet. And we did that for a simple reason. It's because the agencies and the advertisers said to us, if you want to monetize this new platform, make it easy for us to buy. So we said, fine, we'll come up with an ad unit that kind of feels like magazines or newspaper, and we'll sell it to you in CPMs. Right? We basically said, we'll take your model and we'll stick it online. Whereas all the brand people that I talked to and the CMOs I talked to said, hey, this is great. We're going to have a dialogue with users. We didn't create a dialogue, right? We created a broadcast medium that actually was a little bit better at targeting and gave you some more, was maybe more accountable on the back end. We moved from CPM to CPC to CPA, right? So we have more accountability. But we've basically taken an industry and kind of stuck it in, put a square peg in a round hole. We just don't believe in our world that's where we should be. Right? Our consumers expect more from us. And so when we think about the role that advertisers play in our world, advertisers actually have to flip the whole system upside down. You have to think, how do you provide value? Right? How do you have dialogue with users? Kathleen spent a lot of time earlier talking about how she's leveraging Facebook and Twitter and the other social media environments, right? It wasn't just about how do you broadcast into those. It wasn't, hey, big, flashy, blinky things. It was, how do you have a dialogue? How do you understand your consumers? How do you engage with them in a way that really the medium was designed to do, but no one's done yet? Our whole platform we built to connect. We used to have IAB standard inventory. We sold billions, trillions of impressions on IAB standard inventory, right? We just didn't feel it was what the consumer wanted. So literally, the beginning of last year, the beginning of 2010, we took it all down, right? Again, walking away from hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars. But that's Mark. That's Facebook. As a commercial guy, I go, right? Like, that doesn't make sense to me. But the product guys were like, you know what, Blake? At the end of the day, for us to continue to grow, for us to bring real value to the advertising community, we have to get rid of some of those the preconceived notions that they have. We have to stop behaving in a way that just reinforces the way the world's been done before. So everything we do around our ads platform is designed to engage, allow brands to connect. It's not banner advertising. It's engagement platform. The Pages platform, which allows brands to go and publish, was a simple concept. People used to come to us, when I was at Facebook in the beginning, they'd say, hey Blake, we want to create a sponsored group, right, on Facebook. We'd say, great, if you give us $200,000, we'll build that group for you. It was basically a microsite. That's what we did. And I remember Mark coming into a room, we were having a business discussion, he said, well, how many of those we've done? We're like, we've probably done 20, 25 of them for big brands. And he's like, and how many man hours has it taken for us to have a web dev guy doing that? Someone came in with the numbers. And he's like, that makes zero logic to me. He's like, let's give it away. Let's make it a publishing platform. Give it away for free, right? Not put any resources behind it at all, really. Make it social, and then let them do it. Let the agencies and the brands. We were like, oh, no, that's not going to work, right? The agencies want us to build it for them, because they don't have the resource to do it. And how can we charge for that? He's like, don't worry about it. We now have around 2.5 million branded pages. Some are great, right? AirAsia's got 1.3 million users in theirs. 1.3 million users, up 300,000 since in 1 month. The system, the ecosystem has surrounded it and taken care of that. Users have raised their hand and said, yes, we want to be part of it. We have brands all over the world now that are actually removing their branded microsites. Brands like Coca-Cola, big brands, are saying, we're no longer going to build our own sites anymore. Everything's going to sit on Facebook. They're not doing that because they think Facebook's a great thing. They're doing it because that's where users are. They want to engage with and they want to be able to interact with users in a way that's relevant to users. And how do we allow brands to innovate, right? I'll talk a little about innovation a little bit. When I talk about engagement, this is what Facebook ads look like, right? They're not flashy banner. They're polling ads. You know, which are you for Cobra beer, right? Cobra, we love curry. If you do too, join us and let the great curry times roll over 18s only. Which curry are you, vegetable, fowl, or chef's special bounty, right? Hundreds of thousands of people engage with this. When they engage with it, their friends see they engage with it. And there's an organic and viral distribution through the social graph. Yeah. It's allowing people to participate in events. It's allowing people to comment on videos. It's designed for people to do the things they're already doing on Facebook, but to do it with your brands. We spend a lot of time wondering, does this really work, right? We all understand the basic principle that the most reliable source of information, where you go to find information when you go to buy something, is from your friends and family. That's a fact, right? Question is, does it really scale onto Facebook? And so we have two different things, and I'm going to talk a little about this concept of brand advocacy for a moment, okay? On the left-hand side, we have an ad. These are real ads. This is a real campaign that ran for Unilever, for their Dove brand. The left-hand side, it says, you know, go fresh with cool moisture. It's got some copy. It's really standard stuff. The right-hand ad is the exact same ad, the only difference being that at the bottom, it shows the friends of yours that have already done that, that have already become a fan of or liked that page. Is there a difference? Intuitively, you say, sure. So we asked Nielsen to measure that. So Nielsen's done about 200 studies now around the world for us on this. And it's a partnership we have with them. And what they're seeing is there's 68% increase in brand lift, 68% lift in brand metrics when there's what we call the social context. The simple fact that seeing your friend's name in that ad not only increases the actual engagement level, but it also it increases the, all the brand metrics. That's fundamentally different. It might seem simple, but when you talk to CMOs about that, you talk to someone like a Mark Pritchard over at P&G or Keith Weed at Unilever, the light bulb goes on and they go, how do we do that with every piece of advertising on any medium we possibly can? How do we allow our users to become brand ambassadors? How do we do it with scale? Pages are designed to create dialogue. The question is it relevant? There are big brands, and these numbers aren't meant to say you need to get to 4 million or to 15 million users. At the end of the day, if people are evaluating the success of their Facebook campaign based on how many users they have, they've missed the point. I can't tell you how many meetings I walk into and they go, I've got more fans than my competitor does. Seriously, it's an ego thing. And I go, who cares? They go, what do you mean? Like, isn't it, we want to get as many people as possible. I'm like, why? What are you trying to accomplish with that? What's the objective? Folks like Starbucks and folks like AirAsia have built it into the social fabric of their entire marketing platform. Facebook and Twitter sit at the heart of everything Starbucks does. If you walk into any Starbucks store, it directs you to their Facebook page and their Twitter account, right? Because they feel it's important to them. It's woven into the fabric of how they go to market. Their CMO reports on it. Their CEO reports on it to Wall Street. Not because he thinks it's cool or he's got more than his competitor, but because he believes that that audience are his brand ambassadors. They're the most valuable. If you look at people, your most valuable consumers, those are his most valuable consumers. And he's got a direct connection with them. He interacts with them almost on a daily basis. Not trying to sell them coffee, right? He's trying to talk to them about the social being, what's the social values of Starbucks. Yeah, you might talk about the flavor, a seasonal flavor. If a seasonal flavor comes in the U.S. for Thanksgiving with a pumpkin something or other frappuccino. But at the end of the day, that's not the relationship. The relationship is, what are the core values of the company? Because that's what people are buying into. Organic distribution cannot be undervalued, right? There's a concept of bought, owned, and earned, you know, paid, owned, and earned, that's been bubbling around for around 2 years now. And I walk into lots of creative agencies, and I walk into lots of, you know, agency heads and brand heads, and they go, everybody's starting to kind of galvanize around this concept of bought, owned, and earned. People are at various degrees and levels of it. They're trying to figure it out. What does it mean? Who owns it? Some of the big debates I have nowadays are, you know, one of the questions that was asked earlier to Kathleen was, who owns your communities? AirAsia has made the commitment of having local internal people. They've invested in that because it's so important to them. Other people use PR agencies, or their ad agency, or their digital agency, or their media agency. I've seen all sorts of different variables on that. But the idea is, how do you start to measure this? How do you start to understand it? How do you do it in a very predictable way? You know, we look at this very, very closely. Over the next year, we will be coming to market in a very, very strong way around this entire principle of bought, owned, and earned media. Because we think it's something that can be done in a very predictable, scalable way that meets business needs. You know, bought media is ad inventory. Owned media is the content that brands are developing for wherever it's distributed on the internet, not just on Facebook. And the earned are the actual social stories that you get when people interact with your brand. The right to publish in the news feeds. It's very predictable. It's very, very scalable. And then it's measurement. Probably the number one thing we're spending our time on right now as a company is helping brands, advertisers, companies understand the return they get when they spend money on Facebook. Because at the end of the day, you know, it's all great, and bright, shiny object, and what's your Facebook strategy and everything else. If I can't show that I've moved more soap off of a shelf than someone else has, at the end of the day, I can't bring real value. Because that's what companies want to do. You have to move product. Kathleen has to sell more tickets at some point, right? People are measuring down to foot traffic. I'm gonna play a video now for you from a few advertisers that talk about that. But it's a focus for us as a company. You know, and I'd kind of invite folks to participate in that. Because at the end of the day, the business results we're seeing from companies at all sizes, scale, regions around the world are pretty phenomenal. But how do we start to actually make this part of our everyday dialogue versus how many fans do I have or how many impressions did I deliver? What was my click-through rate? Because at the end of the day, I don't care about any of those things. All I care about is if someone spends a dollar on Facebook, they know the ROI they get in the back end of it.
So yes, we continue to advertise in other media, but really this relationship and this conversation that we have started with our consumers will continue for a very long time. It feeds us, it gives us information, it allows us to talk directly from most important consumers.
So going forward, like everybody, you know, one of our most important platforms is mobile. There's a Mary Meeker, who's one of the analysts at Morgan Stanley, who's been following the internet for years and years and years, did her annual report a couple weeks ago. I got a copy of it, and I actually read it on the plane on the way over. They estimate that smartphones will outnumber PCs next year. Not mobile phones, smartphones. That is a transformational change that will have to take place for a lot of companies around the world. The mobility is something that we're hyper focused on. You know, how do we allow people using today? You can use your Xbox. You can connect via Facebook with your friends on Wii. Any of these platforms, consoles, we want to be enabled. We want there to be that social fabric, that social layer on top of anything. Any device that you have, we want to be able to connect it with your friends and your family. And we're seeing that increasingly become important in people's lives. And then new products. So new products is something that we spend a lot of time thinking about. Again, it has to go back to the core value of users. We don't launch products just to launch products. It's not in our DNA. It has to provide intrinsic value to the user experience on Facebook. So whether it be Places, which is the product we launched, which allows people to check in, based on geolocation-based services. Questions, social plugins, which is referenced in the Levi's example, which allows, Levi's itself. A great example of a social plugin in the US, a company called Best Buy, which is a big retailer, electronics retailer. When you go into Best Buy and you say, I'm gonna buy a 40-inch plasma screen Toshiba television, whatever it might be, there's a button that says, ask your friends. If I hit that button, into my friend's news feeds appears a story saying, Blake's about to buy this Toshiba 60-inch television. What do you think? Right. It's happening on their site, not our site. The concept of social plugins, which has been adopted by around 500,000 websites, is allowing the social experience on Facebook to take place on their environments versus requiring people to come through Facebook. Credits is an extension of Places. Credits isn't available in the Asian market yet. But credits essentially allows people, when they're going to check in to whatever retail location it is, to receive a benefit for doing that. It could be check in now to your local coffee shop, and you get a free muffin when you buy a coffee. As simple as that. And then RFID. So the RFID technology, I think, is fascinating. I'm seeing it pop up in a really experimental way around the world. Coca-Cola is doing some fascinating things with it now in Israel, where literally they're putting wristbands that have an RFID chip, and you walk up and they'll give it to teenagers, and teenagers will walk into a participating location and they just flash the RFID as they go through. It automatically updates their Facebook account saying, hey, Blake's at the local cinema, and he goes to see this movie. So the ability to carry your identity with you into physical locations is something that I think we're going to see more and more of. It does require a different way of thinking. Right? I hope I've given you a flavor of Facebook, how we think about the world, how we think about advertising, the role of brands within the social graph. If you have any questions, Stephen Dolan is at stdolan, D-O-L-A-N, at fb.com. More than happy to come on over and visit you guys and spend some time with you. I think I've got a little bit of time for questions, if there are any questions. Yeah, I guess there's a microphone coming down.
Hi, my name is Patrick. I'm from Indonesia, where we have some 30 million Facebook users. Mm. My question is this.
Second largest country in the world now, by the way.
Exactly. Yeah. Thank you very much. My question is this. Has the advertising approach that you share with us has taken a toll at the traditional advertising agencies? Has their revenue gone down because of the social self-made campaign, if you will, by companies direct into Facebook?
Did everybody understand? So the question was, have traditional advertising agencies suffered because of the new form of advertising? I'd say no. Right? I think that I spent a lot of time with the CEOs of a lot of the advertising agencies and media agencies around the world, and they're trying to figure it out. They realize they have to play a role in that, and clients are looking to them to play a role in that and help guide them into this world versus trying to go around them. Now, some are doing a better job than others in terms of adopting and embracing. Some are trying to put their heads in the sand and hoping it goes away. That's not a strategy I'd recommend. But we do think that in especially certain parts of the world, that Facebook will help accelerate digital spend. And we are seeing that in Latin America significantly right now, and some of the Asian markets as well, where some are going from 3-4% digital spend to significantly higher. It's being driven by the brands versus the agencies. The brands are saying we need to get there, and they're forcing the agencies to adapt. And we want to work with both the agencies and the brands to help them figure it out. We think the agencies play a critical role. There are some brands that will go it alone, and Kathleen talked earlier that they do a lot of it themselves. There are a lot of brands that just aren't structured to do that. Right? They don't have the internal resources to do it. They expect their agencies to play a role. And so we have to help everybody, all those key constituents, moving forward. Any other questions? Jen?
Hi, I'm Maria from Singapore. I would like to know, because it's very easy for me to understand how to target consumers through Facebook. In my case, in my company, we are business to business. So I would like to know, how can I connect with my clients? Let's say it's in the pharmaceutical industry. So demographics right now doesn't help me. So is there any way like Facebook can help me to connect my brand to those people who work in the pharmaceutical industry?
It's a question I actually get a lot. And I'm always frustrated with the answer I have to give, because it's never a really good one. Because Facebook's very social versus a business, there are some environments like LinkedIn or some of the other players that allow you to go in and target specific professions or industries. Facebook doesn't necessarily allow you to do that. There's lots of keyword targeting and things like that, but if you're talking about the pharmaceutical industry, it's hard to find. People are not putting in their Facebook, I work in the pharmaceutical industry. Right? You can target by company. You can target, there are ways to get to some of that information. I've never been one of those people who say that Facebook's the first place you should go for B2B advertising. I have a hard time standing here telling you that. So there's some keyword targeting, but it's not really designed for that. I mean, it's more about people connecting with people, and that makes it a challenge for you guys. I wish I had a better answer for you. I guess I always feel badly with that answer, but at least it's an honest answer.
Hi, I'm Jackie from Clickthrough Singapore. Just want to ask, what does Facebook think about the Groupon business model and in respect to the places that you guys have launched and credits? And what do you think about Google buying Groupon?
I can't speak to the. I can't. I just found out about it 2 hours ago, so I'd be hard pressed to give a corporate position on what our opinion of that is. We think Groupon's an interesting business model. The ability that activating people to build, to aggregate spending power in order to get discounts, is been very, very popular all over the world. So there are Groupon and Groupon type companies in a lot of markets now. Check-ins for us is our equivalent, allowing people to go in and check in, and then to get a credit, Facebook credits against that. They're not the exact same. They're not apples to apples. We look at lots of those commercial models. Groupon's one of our biggest, one of our biggest application players. So we're very close to the Groupon folks, and we hope to continue that relationship. Those kind of models are going to pop up all the time. There's going to be all sorts of new commercial models that are going to bubble up and will get embraced for a period of time and may drift off, or they may explode and become the next big thing, like a Zynga or a Farmville. But Groupon's a great company. I know a lot of the guys I worked with at Yahoo who are running that company. And we wish them really well and hope the relationship with Google's a good one for them. We're done?
Sorry.
That's it. We're done. All right, thanks, everybody.